Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan, and Alex is missing at the moment. He's going to be with me shortly. I know it. He has things. He does things now. Like, he's important and popular. Whatever. Anyway, I am not alone. I am very happy to be joined by Ian Price and Stephen Mattson. Ian, Steve, thank you for joining me.
Hello.
And hello. You're very welcome. Thank you for having us.
Oh, yes, absolutely. People may be wondering why there are two people on the show. Actually, we have two people on the show all the time. But you are actually conjoined. I'm going to call you conjoined.
Oh, dear.
by the fact that you are actually working on the newest version of Honor for Nine Dragon.
That is correct. Ian is the one who started, and when the workload was something that one person was having a little trouble balancing, I got pulled in by him, so that's my line into the project.
Excellent. So to start up, like we have a lot to talk, I'm sure, about Honor and what's going on with that currently. But I do want to talk a little bit about your background, and I'm going to start with Ian. So Ian, you have been working in game development. I guess we can say you've been working in game development for a fortnight. Is it an actual fort year? Like if I'm thinking like 2004. And that's 14 years. Is that a fort year?
I don't know if that's a word, but we can make that a word, a fort year, a 14-year period.
Sure.
It's been about that long since my first professional foray into freelance game writing. And in that time, I've done several freelance projects and published a couple of my own card games. Right now, I'm really happy to be doing the freelance work with Nine Dragons on Honor, as well as working on taking one of my card games, the one called Bad Decisions, and working on turning it into a mobile app.
Oh, now I can have Bad Decisions on the run.
Well, not just yet, but hopefully soon.
Bad Decisions go. I can catch all the bad decisions.
That would be a pretty good metaphor.
Yeah, one of the first things you worked on was some freelance work for White Wolf, correct?
That's correct. This was back before all of the mergers and the split off of Onyx Path to do the RPG line. Back when it was just White Wolf Publishing, I worked with Matt McFarland and Will Hindmark as the developers, and I was freelance writing for the Vampire the Requiem game line on the Ghouls, Carthians, and Requiem Chroniclers guidebooks.
Oh, okay. So that's different than Masquerade.
Yeah. For anybody who's not familiar with the World of Darkness and Chronicles of Darkness lines, yeah. Although back then it was Old World of Darkness and New World of Darkness because they hadn't come up with the Chronicles of Darkness name scheme, et cetera, et cetera. So Vampire the Masquerade was the original 90s product that by the time I was working with White Wolf had reached its original we've wrapped up this game line, and Requiem was the new line that they were publishing with their new 2000s line of products. And so that was the one that I worked on.
I see. Yeah. I mean, the World of Darkness has seemed very appealing. People have been talking to me more about it now. I don't have a real frame of reference for it, but I get the fact that there are like vampires. And ghouls, you had worked on ghouls as well.
So in this context, ghouls are people who are still alive and mortal humans, but they have drunk some vampire blood, and so they are bound to a vampire who gets some mental control over them, but they also get some vampire powers.
So I'm a ghoul, but I also I'm kind of a vampire. I'm just not called a vampire because the cool kids are vampires.
Basically, as a ghoul, you can't just go up to anybody and drink their blood and get power from it.
Oh.
But also you can go out in sunlight. You can only get power from drinking vampire blood, which vampires have already stolen from somebody else and made magical by, you know, being a vampire.
Oh, I'm a vampire vampire.
Kind of. A couple of the special things in the book talked about certain ghoul families that no longer had a vampire as their master, and they hunted vampires to get more blood.
The real twist there is that in the World of Darkness setting, the ghouls are humans who have either willingly or unwillingly realized, oh wait, the blood is now magic, and if we drink it from the vampires, we're magic too. To a point.
Oh, okay. That's clever.
But most of the time, the ghouls serve the vampires because, as previously mentioned, when you drink blood from a vampire, that vampire gets some mental control over you.
Oh, okay. Kind of like the thrall situation.
Exactly. It's like Renfield from the book.
Exactly.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no one wants to be Renfield, though. Give me any other character.
No, please, give me Quincy. Quincy's much better.
Who was Quincy?
Quincy, if I'm remembering right, is one of the characters that is often forgotten about in Dracula, but he's the American big game hunter.
Oh, okay.
Actually really important in the final chase to bring down Dracula, but everyone forgets about the supporting characters because they're so invested in Jonathan and Van Helsing and the viewpoint characters.
Right. I think the most recent thing that I'm familiar with when it comes to like vampires and such was actually Penny Dreadful. And Van Helsing dies pretty quick in that. So you just have to use other characters as your narrative follow through.
Ooh, I actually want to watch that now. I'd never actually tuned in, so oh, now yeah. I think I might have to.
Well, it has something to do with vampires, but it also has a lot to do with like Frankenstein and Dorian Gray. There were some others that were in that line. But yeah, Van Helsing was one of the characters, but he did not last long. There were some vampires involved, and they were mean.
The main difference between Masquerade, which came before and then is being resurrected again now, which mm-hmm. is kind of appropriate for vampires, yes. and Requiem, is that Masquerade was a lot heavier on meta plot and this is the setting and these are the things going on in the background that your local vampire scene is going to be influenced by, whereas Requiem was much bigger on, here's a toolbox for GMs to build your own meta setting out of and build your own city with important things happening to your vampires in it.
Okay, so it would be sort of like the difference. I always love trying to do this as being the novice. It would be the difference between like a Dungeons and Dragons and like a Cypher system.
I'm not familiar enough with Cypher to say whether that would work, but within Dungeons and Dragons, it's the difference between playing in the Forgotten Realms, where tons of stuff is going on, and playing in your DM's homebrewed setting that they used the Dungeon Master's Guide and Unearthed Arcana to build.
So, like the Tal Dorei of that kind of...
Yeah, very much. And Cypher System is really a very apt metaphor for Chronicles of Darkness, because if you look at Cypher System, what Mr. Cook has done is he's got the Cypher System core book, which has a little bit of words about possible settings, but then you've also got games like The Strange, and I forget, is Numenera actually powered by Cypher System, or is that its own thing?
I thought it was, but I might be wrong.
I think it is too, because I remember Numenera came out before Cypher System was a thing, so I forget which was which, but everything is, all of the little ones floating around, all the settings are powered by this core, but the core doesn't require any of the settings. And that's the thing with Chronicles of Darkness. The core book, the core game is, here's the rules, here's some basic assumptions that you're in a supernatural horror world, you're interacting with supernatural weirdness in some way, you're disadvantaged because you never see all of it, go. And then vampires like, and here's the tools for playing a vampire in this game, and then mages, here's the tools for playing a wizard in this game, and they're self-contained, but they need that core engine to go, but you can also play games with just the core engine.
I see. Okay. Yeah, my understanding of the Cypher system in relation to Numenera was that it was similar to, like, when Fantasy Flight had Edge of Empire, and then they made the Genesis system, which was very much still the same storytelling dice kind of thing. But you could use whatever setting you wanted for it.
Same rough pattern there, yeah.
And since I'm still on Ian, in the fort year that you've been working on, I'm going to make that a word for this episode, fort year, Nathan's new term. Since I just mentioned Fantasy Flight, you actually did work for Fantasy Flight on a few projects.
Yeah, I did a brief freelancing stint with Fantasy Flight, writing a little bit of unit descriptions and faction lore for their Rune Wars Minis game. I ended up turning down further work with that because while it was a kind of interesting set of work to write that setting material for, I found that the process working with them just didn't fit very well for me because there was a long reporting chain that I was at the very end of. And so I felt like there was a lot of things that I tried to do that I was told, no, you can't actually go that direction with this when word came back from the other end.
Reporting chains are always fun, aren't they? Regardless of what industry you're in.
I've found that regardless of the industry you're in, it is best to flatten the reporting chains as much as possible and to democratize the responsibility and the actual authority to make decisions within them if you want to get things done. And so I just felt like the situation, I was not able to provide the quality product that they wanted. And so I bowed out of further work with them, but I did have a good time. And I think that we did good work together for the projects that I actually completed.
Okay. Excellent. And then you had two different card games. We had just talked about Bad Decisions, but you also had Kitsune?
Yes. Kitsune of Foxes and Fools was the first game that I published. It came out around the same time that Delve Podcast was starting in 2014.
Oh, yes.
That was around the time that I met Dominic and that the first edition of Honor was being put together as well. As I was learning some of my lessons, I was sharing them with Dominic around that time. And that's how I came to end up being on this show, really. But talking about the game itself, Kitsune is a strategy game that, to be candid, one of the places that I started with the mechanics, there were two places that I started with the mechanics of it. Place number one, I had made a bunch of Kitsune characters that I had role-played with Steve in some games like Legend of the Five Rings, and I had made them as fantasy fan cards for the Legend of the Five Rings card game. I was never going to be able to print these cards out and put them in card sleeves and like play them with even just my friends who play this game. What if I made my own game? And then at the same time, I had been playing Munchkin with people and also Space Pirate Amazon Ninja Cat Girls, another Steve Jackson game. And I looked at the mechanics of those Steve Jackson card games and thought, I could do this, but better.
Right.
So Kitsune is a similar sort of take that to your neighbor and push your luck, but kind of inverted because you're choosing spend resources now or rely on luck now or don't rely on luck, but gather my resources sort of game, where you are just like Munchkin trying to race to the finish. But instead of gaining levels, you're gaining tails as a magical fox spirit.
Perfect. I have a little bit of the Amaterasu thing. Well, no, Amaterasu was a wolf. But that kind of setting.
Same kind of imagery, though.
Yeah, okay. I like to have as many tails as possible. I can have nine of them.
Yeah, the multiple-tailed beast thing in Japanese mythology comes out of the Buddhist and Hindu influences that came into Japan through China. Because in Buddhist mythology, rooted in the Hindu mythology, multiples of a limb signify spiritual enlightenment and power. And so when you have a beast with more legs and tails and heads and things like that than it normally should have, that is a symbol that it is a powerful god beast rather than a normal beast. You may remember the forest god from Princess Mononoke that had all of those legs.
Okay.
That's the same kind of symbolism going on there.
Oh.
So in the game Kitsune, I take that mythology of, so more tails is more enlightenment. So you start off as a two-tailed fox. You're not a regular mortal fox with one tail. You're a basic god fox. and you have to prove to the elder foxes that you are ready to be a full-on nine-tailed fox. Mm-hmm. And so as you prove how tricky and enlightened you are, you earn more tails.
And then, of course, bad decisions, which is sort of, you were saying it's sort of akin to Cards Against Humanity sort of thing.
Yeah, if you think of Cards Against Humanity, Joking Hazard, Apples to Apples, Snake Oil, all of these games where you're taking the cards and putting them together like Legos to make jokes.
Right.
Lego for Jokes is actually a term for the genre that was coined by the Loading Ready Run crew.
Okay.
Bad Decisions takes a Mad Libs sort of twist on it.
Oh.
Because you have the story cards, which are the prompts, which have a fill-in-the-blank prompt with one or two sentences. Mm-hmm. And the blanks have spaces that correspond to the other three types of cards, the Fool, Crisis, and Bad Decision cards. You will have in your hand five each of the Fool, Crisis, and Bad Decision cards. Each player will take turns drawing a story card, filling in the first two blanks from their hand, and then everybody else will try to make a punchline by filling in the last blank from their hand, and then the player who set up the story will pick the best of those punchlines, in their opinion, and that person will get the story card as a point.
Oh, okay. And then it's going to be a mobile game.
Yes, we are currently working with a group called Early Bird Software, who are also local to the Chicago area, and we are developing the game. We're probably going to do it on iOS first, because that's the most expensive and difficult of the platforms that we want to get it on, so we want to get it there first, and then expand out to other mobile and probably also PC and console if we can manage it.
That's very exciting. The idea that, you know, I can be on my phone and make bad decisions is very appealing to me.
I think people can do that already, but this way they could do it with other people. Well, they can probably do that already, but have more fun with it with fewer consequences.
I see.
So we're working with a software group who are doing the actual coding. We in-house, when I say we, I'm talking about me, my mother, and my brother. We are the core team that published both of the card games that I've been talking about, because mom has 35 years in the publishing industry as an editor and layout and production person. Mm-hmm. And my brother does graphic art and illustration. So we've got a really good core team for publishing physical card games, which is why we were able to do a couple of them. We've brought in some outside talent to do the coding of the app with us. And so we're going to be working with them to implement the design that we have into code and then to market it.
Apps always seemed like such a great idea, and at the same time seemed like they were so over my head that I couldn't fathom what it would actually take to put one together.
It's definitely been a learning experience, both in learning the technological aspects and in learning the financial aspects. I've learned a lot over the past 2 years that we've been seriously looking at the app proposition about ways that it is possible to put together funding and financing for a major business growth project.
That's got to be, well, for me, it would just be a giant headache, of which I would need.
Honestly, it's not the part of the business that I'm super excited about, but I am excited about the goal that it serves. Right. So I put up with the parts of it that are less fun.
Fair enough. And Steven, I've been leaving you in the lurch here, but I do want to talk a little bit about your background. Now, you have been involved in the role-playing community for a really long time, but this is really your first freelancing assignment.
It really is my first major freelancing assignment. I've done several adventures. I've written things for conventions. I've written things for fanzines, but this is my first big publishing freelancing assignment. Yes.
Okay. Excellent. So let's go to the Wayback Machine for a second here, because I love the Wayback Machine. You mentioned you do a lot of GMing.
I really do.
Now, how far back does that go for you?
That goes seriously. That goes back to honestly the early to mid 90s is when I decided to take it as more than just something one member of the group had to do. Otherwise, we didn't have a game. I my first experience with role playing games was really young. It was back in 1988-89. I was 6 or 7 years old. Okay. And I was playing with some cousins, some friends, and we were not doing a very good job of it. But someone had to be the GM, and that often ended up being me. And then sometime during the mid-90s, I realized that, well, hey, I can take this, and right now it's kind of a thankless job that no one really enjoys, and the players think I'm the bad guy, and I think the players are jerks, and it's just this really bad loop. And I could work on it, and I could turn this into something, to a skill to be proud of, because it doesn't have to be this way. It doesn't have to be this antagonistic rocks fall, everyone dies, you're bad adventurers type of thing.
Right. I noticed that a mysterious EXP Limited has joined us.
There is another person. It's me.
And Alex, we were actually just, we had been talking about Ian's extensive background for the Fortyear, which is still a term I'm going to make work in game design. But we were just talking to Steven a little bit about his history of GMing. You're familiar with GMing.
A little bit, yeah. Mostly 3.5, though.
It's a solid system.
One of the things that Steve has really brought to the table is that although I may have more actual professional publication credits, Steve has experience with more role-playing game systems and actually running games in them than I can actually name.
Good to know. When you started, Steve, what system were you actually using?
When I first started, it was Dungeons & Dragons, and I think we were using some awful, awful hybrid of Zero Edition, First Edition Revised, and Advanced Second Edition, but not regular Second Edition.
Oh. But you're not going to tell them the story of the mall.
I'm not going to tell the... Oh, no. Okay, so...
Tell us about the mall, Steve.
When I really started, there's a publishing company named Palladium Games, which some people may have heard of. Palladium. I've never been entirely clear on the...
I feel like I know this company.
Okay, so the really short history of Palladium Games is they began as Kevin Sembieta's brainchild to legitimize his Dungeons & Dragons fan rules with his own system, the Palladium Fantasy System. And because TSR actually went out of business for a period of time before Wizards of the Coast bought them, Palladium is now the world's oldest running, continually operating role-playing game publisher.
Oh, wow.
Their games are interesting, and that's a rabbit hole I will refrain from diving down. But
I'm going to look them up while you talk, don't worry.
Yep, me too.
The important part is one of their games is called Heroes Unlimited, which was my personal first experience with a superhero role-playing game. Oh. And there's a lot of pros and cons to say about Heroes Unlimited, and I actually have a huge soft spot for it, but one thing I do not have a soft spot for is the shopping mall. You see, in the back of Heroes Unlimited, the edition that we started with, I have no idea what edition that was. I think it was like the third printing of the first edition. Don't quote me on that because I really don't remember. There was a sample adventure, and this sample adventure was like supposed to be, looking back on it, it was supposed to be like an introductory adventure for your team of superheroes. And it basically boiled down to, oh no, the bad guys have taken hostages in the shopping mall, and your team has to get into the shopping mall and rescue the hostages because one of them is a super important scientist. And there's a subplot about how the villains actually don't care about the hostages. They just want to get the scientist for his super weapon. And, you know, standard comic book stuff.
Right.
And if it had stopped there, it would have been, oh, that's cute. It did not stop there, and this is where it leaves Palladium Games and goes firmly into my local group, because when I joined up with this particular group, they said, cool, we're playing Heroes Unlimited. I'm like, cool, what's that? And we go through the explanation, and they run through this shopping mall scenario. It's like, oh, this is fun. Yeah, we're playing next week. We come back, and they run through this shopping mall scenario. Okay. Well, that's familiar, but okay, we're playing next week, and I come back next week, and they run through this shopping mall scenario. But every time something would be a little different. It's like, oh, well, you know, this time there's rules for a tank in the game. So we've somehow incorporated a tank into the food courts. and this continued for some time. And then it's like, I had a chance to, hey, would you like to run it? Oh, sure. I'd like to have a chance at this. Cool. Here's the shopping mall diagrams. Well, do I have to run the shopping mall? Oh yeah. That's what the book says. And I ran the shopping mall several times to Young Me's credit. I think it got more and more over the top supervillainy each time. There was like an alien lab in the JCPenney's at one point, and the floor of the main promenade was glass, and there were sharks swimming under it, and people could fall through the glass and get eaten by sharks. There were no rules; they would just get eaten by the sharks.
Okay,
because I was very young.
But yeah.
Then at one point I mentioned, oh, hey, well, what if I've got all these ideas. What happens to the villains after the shopping mall? And the group just went dead quiet and looked at me. And I had this vague feeling that something, I had just said something incredibly wrong. And I was not invited back after that point, because I found out later I had suggested playing the game wrong in a way that was not supported by the rules, because the rules said you played in the shopping mall.
So how's that group doing?
Absolutely no idea. I lost contact with them the first time I went off to college, and I haven't actually looked back. I miss a couple of them, but I haven't actually looked back since.
Do any of them know you're working on and designing tabletop games now?
Imagine that one or two of them actually might, because like one or two of them were more into reading the market and purchasing other games than just playing Heroes Unlimited. But I couldn't actually say for certain. And I kind of hope they do, because, hey, guys, turns out you can leave the shopping mall.
Yeah, yeah. I have to ask, this wasn't like the Willamette shopping mall, was it? Because I feel like this is like a Dead Rising scenario waiting to happen.
I mean, if I were to revisit that idea now and initially dreamed about inflicting this on my weekly role-playing group of actually taking the shopping mall and turning it into some sort of ironic commentary on purgatory and creativity, mm-hmm. and intentionally running a game like this.
Yeah.
But you ended up reworking that idea into an actual Legend of the Five Rings ghost story you still have to run for us eventually.
Yes, I still have to run 10 Days in Kaidan for you guys.
Can you just summon an Oni and be like, just end it all?
You could. Yes, that is actually one of the endings that the players could do. It is a bad ending, but it is an ending the players could do, yes.
It's still better than being stuck in the damn shopping mall.
There is that too.
So as I look up just what Palladium does now, it looks like one of the big things they do is rifts. And little do people know, every one of those rift worlds also set in a shopping mall.
Oh no! Turns out you can get to any of the rift worlds through the shopping mall.
Exactly. No,
Atlantis was definitely basically one big shopping mall.
Oh yeah,
in the rifts universe. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
The trick here is that you need to find a way to get there through the shopping mall, and I'm gonna tell you right now, the rift is in the Beyond section of Bed Bath &
Beyond. Oh, goodness.
Big Bed Bath & Way Beyond. I'm pretty sure Savage Worlds you get to through Hot Topic.
That would make sense.
I thought so.
No, I think you get there through Forever 21, because it's much more basic.
It's forever?
Ooh.
That was a fun little dive there. Anyway, Palladium, check it out.
Yes. They get a lot of rap because honestly their mechanics have not evolved since functionally the days of AD&D first edition. They're very much stuck in a perpetual 1991 mode.
Right.
And there's a lot that we as a hobby have learned from them, but there's some stuff that Palladium actually embodies. There's laundry lists of baggage with Palladium, and I can't unpack them all, but one reason they will always have a huge soft spot in my heart, despite the fact that they're very bad at communicating, despite the fact that they're so entrenched, is that early on, Kevin Symbieta, the head, and right now I think the main writer for Palladium, said balance is important in a role-playing game, but it's not always about numerical parity. It's not always about my plus five is equal to your plus five, and we can all accomplish the same things. It's really a lot more about working together as the GM and the group, and making certain that every character feels their time in the spotlight is equally meaningful. It's not even about having equal time in the spotlight. It's about your time in the spotlight needs to be equally meaningful in contribution. If you have a game about a street kid and a mecha pilot,
Yeah. Well,
if it's a fighty game, the mecha pilot is going to win every time. So how do you incorporate this? You make sure the game is not just fighting giant robots with your mecha. Mm-hmm. You make sure that the street kid has equal opportunity to contribute meaningfully in their spotlight time, and you make sure they get that spotlight time. And that's something that's stuck with me ever since, because it's like that's not something that a lot of people naturally realize. We like to frame things in the case of, well, the wizard can put out an average of 18 damage around, but it's in like two big spikes, but the fighter can only put out an average of 15 damage around, but he can do that every round,
right?
And that's not the only way to look at balance,
right? Yeah.
And that's Palladium's main contribution to me, besides the fact that, you know, sometimes it's okay just to have a gonzo idea and just run with it.
Right. Yeah.
Forever.
Yeah.
In the shopping mall.
Forever in that shopping mall. You know, if you're looking at like the original Dungeons and Dragons and that rule set, there are still people who really have a personal relationship with that kind of system and just don't want to move on from it anyway. They just like that system. So there's a market for it. I understand it.
There are really only three kinds of role-playing system. There is currently supported.
Yep.
There is no longer supported, but still perfectly playable. And there was, oh my lord, who wrote this? I don't think I can actually play this game.
Yes.
Ooh. I know one of those, oh my lord, who wrote this? I can't actually play this game.
Yes.
But we don't talk about Fatal on the show.
No, we don't.
That's the go-to example, but you could go for so much less playable than Fatal.
Like,
have you heard Fatal's of Dead Earth?
Oh, God.
Yeah, yes. We've talked to the creator. JT Smith.
That's awesome.
He's the guy behind the Game Crafter.
Yeah, that's what he does now. He started Game Crafter.
Really?
Yes, yeah. That's the same guy.
I did not know JT was behind Dead Earth. I have met JT, and I knew he was behind Game Crafter. I did not know he was behind Dead Earth.
Yeah, he made that. Amazing. That was his first game.
We're pretty sure that we're talking about the same thing, right? Yeah, same one. You can die during character creation.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I found out about that too. Dyson mutant, Logos.
Yeah. The mutant hyperactive crotch fungus.
That sounds right, yeah.
So if I may have dispensation to say one real hot take about Fatal, actually.
Go ahead.
Having actually looked at it, and because, you know, it gets a very deserved bad rap. I'm not here to,
yeah,
very I am not here to praise Fatal in any way, shape, or form. I'm here to condemn it in the worst of all terms, because the thing about Fatal is that it's boring. If you take away all the shock value, if you take away all the horrible things and you just look at the core mechanics, it doesn't do anything interesting at all.
Yeah.
It is, here's D&D, but less interesting.
Yeah.
If you just rename all of the shock value stats to something that is completely neutral and mechanical oriented.
Mm-hmm. Or even just strip them out because they don't have much use in resolution.
Yeah.
A, you realize that most of them don't do anything, and then B, you realize that the system is actually just boring and stupid.
So unfortunately, it's perfectly playable. It's just there's nothing there.
Right.
Original D&D was more interesting.
To go briefly back to the subject of RPGs that are not actually playable, there's one that Steve and I have mourned before, because the books are so beautiful and some of the setting stuff in them is so interesting, but the system is just utterly unusable. It's called Alpha Omega.
That sounds familiar, but I have never looked at it.
I've actually talked to someone on Twitter who played a game lasting over a year, and I am in awe.
They had to give the starting characters the equivalent amount of experience points of having played like 300 sessions to bring starting characters up to the level of ability to be able to make easy difficulty checks.
Yeah.
Oh, geez.
Well, let's see. When the difficulty to make a check is 35 for an easy difficulty check. And the system is roll your dice and add them together, and then add your skill. And the dice are derived from your stat, and the average human's average stat is 15, which derives into 4d4, which can max out at 16, and dice don't explode without magical powers, which take a separate roll to activate. But you add your skill, but a very high legendary skill person has plus 10 to plus 12. 14 plus 12 is 26, which is still less than an easy difficulty roll. And can we actually play this game? I don't know. And that's not even going into the subsegments of initiative, and that's not going into how damage is calculated. And the books are so pretty, it's not fair. It's not fair.
My head hurts. I don't know what's going on.
It's the prettiest game you'll never play. And I never shy away from mechanical crunch, but I shy away from mechanical crunch here.
You don't like mechanical crunch that needs you to be a NASA engineer?
And still fail.
Fun fact, we have a PhD who works at NASA as a member of our gaming group from time to time. And she helped us verify that those rules don't work.
Yep.
NASA disapproved.
Sorry.
Not an official statement from NASA.
No. Our opinions are our own.
I've got a friend that I played WoW with that works for JPL. So.
Oh, that's awesome.
She's not like doing anything rocketeering or anything. She's in accounting. But the point is, it's neat.
On that brief note, our friend at NASA is actually working on the GEDI satellites.
Nice. See, it's cool having people in space stuff. Doesn't matter what they're doing, they're in space stuff.
Space stuff is the best stuff. So yeah, we did mention the RPG that usually goes completely unnamed on this episode. Our conversations occasionally have gone to that certain piece of content, and I usually try to truncate them. Did in this case too. But hey, you know what? If you're a patron, you get to hear even more of that conversation, in addition to a whole bunch of conversation about bagpipes and such. You know, our interview was actually about 3 hours long when we got done with this. We had a lot to discuss. And, I mean, that's kind of obvious to see. I mean, we haven't even gotten to the part where we were going to talk about honor. That's going to be on the next episode, because we had so much to talk about just with what Steven and Ian have done previously. So you can imagine all of the wacky hijinks we got up to. I will give you a brief taste of our bagpipe discussion at the end of this episode. If you like the idea of Kitsune or Bad Decisions, you can go to kitsunecg.com and baddecisionscg.com, which Ian says should be up and operational pretty soon. If you are looking for more of Steven's wacky hijinks, you can go over to twitch.com/jazzelves. Yet you heard me. You can also find them on Twitter at Ian W. A. Price and at Jazz Elves. He has a story behind that he'll explain on the next episode. And of course, if you want to find out more about Honor or Nine Dragons, you can go to www.ninedraninensrpg.com. It's like Nine Dragons, but the G is a 9. I will have a link in the description of the episode. Never fear. I'm here for you. That's what I do. Also, you can find everything about Delve over at DelveCast.com. Please go there, check everything out. If you want to find out about our Patreon and that incredibly long episode with all of that content that we had to take out, including my 40 minutes talking to them before we even actually started the episode, you can find that right there. And again, thank you to our shiny level patrons, Bonnie Ainsworth and, oh, look at that, Dom Perry from Nine Dragons. He will be so thrilled to see that full episode and hear the people that he suggested come on the show, because he just started working with them. And they had so much to talk about. So thank you for, one, supporting the show, and two, suggesting guests for us to have on the show. We really appreciate it. You can also find us on iTunes and Google Play and pretty much everywhere else that podcasts are well procured, not sold, because that would suggest we get paid for the procured in some way. Please rate and review and subscribe. That's kind of like a moral support payment. So that's great. You can also find us on Twitter. I am at Citanium. Alex is at EXP Limited, and the show is at Delve Podcast. So we will return on the next show talking about some of the things that are happening with Honor and some of the systems that they've been working on, the chase system, wounds, and somehow we even ended up talking about Yankee Candles. It's just, you'll understand when we get there. Until then, thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye. I don't want to pick up the cello. It's not going to help if I try to pick up the cello.
Exactly. Or, ooh, I want to learn to play the bagpipes, but not so much that I really want to put in that much work. Oof.
Yeah. Well, the bagpipes are kind of a whole different animal into and of themselves. You know, the second you say, I'm going to pick up some bagpipes, you have made a life choice.
Yeah, exactly.
You are not coming back from. That is now, you're the bagpipe guy. That's it.
The path of the warrior is not an easy one to walk.
So in my notes, bagpipes. Okay, good. I'll remember that for post. It's like, okay, bagpipes, definitely a thing.
Oh, goodness.